Perfect. Thanks a lot for the introduction, and thanks a lot for pronouncing my name correctly. It's a tough job, I know. So congratulations to the faculty around Andrew for setting up this meeting. It's fantastic, and this mode is really something we can maybe have more of in the future. So thanks again for this. So I always show this picture on this the Swiss Alps to impress the audience, but I don't think if this really works in Denver, where we have some Rocky Mountains around the corner, but let me say I tried. So I have nothing to disclose regarding this talk. And so when we now, the next step, now we found the fistula, as Peter showed us, or the colleagues from yesterday showed as well. So I want to present you the technique on how we would perform transvenous embolization of the CSF venous fistula, and how we want to get there, and what kind of materials you use to really close that leak. And then the next step will be, it's my opinion a little bit, sure, you will hear the bias, what it takes to perform transvenous embolization. And the next step, as my title is called, is why you want to embolize the CSF venous fistula embolization. So when I talk about transvenous embolization, I always refer to this first publication of the first cases from the colleagues from Mayo and from Toronto. And there are a ton of variations for transvenous embolization. And I will just show some of them. So first case to present the technique, it's a classic story, 60-year-old woman with sudden onset of autoestatic headache. They performed the MRI of the brain, and you see classic findings. And this is something we always discuss about findings of SIH and brain imaging. So it can be hard when the signs are just subtle, but this is something nobody should really overlook. And that's what we advocate for, really, really look through the scan, that you don't have a negative case or report negatively, but it's really, really striking. Spinal MRI is just no epidural fluid, so we think about CSF venous fistula. And then what we perform is lateral decubitus myelography, and then we keep the patient free breathing so they can have all the inspiration cycle, respiration cycle, and then you see this, well, yeah, and then you really see like this small vein where the contrast media is flushing away. And when you have CT, then you see the same as well, that you have this small veins, paraspinal veins, filling with contrast media. So this is a clear CSF venous fistula. So what we do is now that you know where you have to go, now you just have to get there. And what we do is we do a transfemoral access through the vein, and then we just advance our catheters and our wires upwards through the right atrium of the heart, and then we just go to the adducens vein. And the good thing is we know where the adducens vein is, right? Because we always perform like myelographies in these patients, and then just can have a look where the origin is, and then you just go in there with your wires. So this is pretty straightforward. Then afterwards, we mostly do a venogram just to see how the anatomy is. And then you have to look where your nerve root or your paraspinal vein is, you want to get into it. Just can't count upwards from 12 to 8 and think, okay, somewhere there it must be. Then you look for where the vein is, do another run. Well, there it is. You see then already all the veins inside your neuroframe, and you see the epidural plexus. This is just a lateral view. You will see this is your target, right? That's where you want to go to. Then afterwards, you advance your microcatheter, any materials you have there and you're familiar with working with and doing the embolization. Do another run so that you're perfectly in the right position to do your embolization, because some of those veins are the venous part of the CSF venous fistula, and this is what you want to occlude. And then afterwards, you take whatever embolic agent you have and you're allowed to use in your country, because that's an issue, especially in the United States, as I heard. And in this case, we just use this embolic agent and then just inject and try to fill all the parts of the CSF venous fistula to really occlude the venous draining part of it. We mostly perform flat panel imaging just to see where the embolic agent really is. And then you can compare it to your myelography. And here you see, okay, this is where all the veins are pathifying with the contrast media through the fistula. And we compare it to where the embolic agent is, you see, okay, we had the embolic agent inside the vessels we tried to occlude. So this is something we always aim for. We bring all patients back for clinical visits and for MRI 4 weeks later. And then you can see, okay, this is prior to embolization, this is afterwards, and you see, okay, the MRI brain normalized and the symptoms dissolved. So this is the let's say, only imaging-proven sign we have that's maybe occluded the fistula itself. That's a problem for CSF-venous fistula because we cannot just prove that the epidural fluid is gone. We just have to rely on clinical findings and on imaging signs from brain MRI if there's some that we can really relate to. There are some variations. Just one of them is it's called like the pressure cooker technique. That you take a catheter with a small balloon on the tip, and then you just have more forward pressure when injecting your embolic agent, just to really be able to penetrate the small vessels in the neuroframe and in the epidural plexus where the fistula is. This looks like this. So this is a balloon that's inflated, and then you see really how the embolic agent is going around the nerve, because you really want to penetrate deep in the anterior and posterior part around the nerve root to really get all the vessels responsible for draining the fistula itself. Another case where we have like 57-year-old male, and we perform lateral decubitus myelography again, what you can see this that really big nerve root cyst, and you really can see nicely how the contrast medium is running out of the cyst. But when you look closely, you see like a level below there, there's another fistula. So this is a case where we have two CSF venous fistula in one patient at the first myelography. Now the question is always like how to treat those. And it's pretty easy. You just do the same axis, and you just treat both of them. And the combination of how you do it is quite depends on what your technique is. Because due to the big cyst, we see that there's not a really nice paraspinal vein at the upper level of the both CSF venous fistula. So what you can do, and this is something you can easily do in most of the cases, is you just enter the lower level, and then you just pass through the epidural plexus, the level above, do your embolization there, and then afterwards you just pull your catheter back, and then through the same axis you just inject on the other level where the other fistula is your embolic agent again, and then you have treated both levels with the same catheter in the same session. And it takes roughly like 10 to 15 minutes extra per level you have to treat. And this is how it looks, and this is something we really want to achieve, that you have just circular embolic agent around the nerve root, and this is something where we consider it should close the venous part of the fistula. This is just one example how to access the fistula. And there are tons of variations. It's a very, very nice picture from the colleagues from Mayo. That's really the standard way through the esophagus vein is like mostly considered the standard way you want to go to for, let's say, 80% of the fistulas. But here there are tons of variations. If they're upper thoracic spine or lower, you can pass through the epidural plexus. So there's always a way to go to the fistula itself. A very, very nice paper. So next point, what does it take to perform a transvenous embolization? This is a little bit so because there's no data or no guideline for this. Is a little bit my opinion, what I think should be necessary. And what you need, sure, is like you need a neurointerventionalist with a proper end use suit that you can perform neurovascular stuff. And you need a neurointerventionalist that is dedicated to the disease, because it's sure, it's not an aneurysm, it's not stroke, and it's not an AVM. So some neurointerventionalists I know would consider SH being boring, because it's not just this fancy brain intervention stuff. And this neurointerventionist should be part of a team involved in diagnostic workup and discussing cases, not just like mercenary style interventionists to perform the procedures itself. What's really helpful is you need to know how to handle the necessary materials for transvenous embolization, but luckily they are identical to what we use for aneurysms and AVMs. So this is quite helpful when you do this kind of treatments. You have the techniques already at your hand to perform the other ones. And the next thing you really, really need to know is you have to have some anatomical understanding how to get to the epidural fistula and to the epidural plexus, and how you safely can perform venous intervention around the spinal cord. That's really, really important. So next part, and now, like I said, it's the title of my talk, Why or Why Not to Embolize? Because there are no comparative studies, it's a little bit biased from my side, sure, but the other colleagues will have the chance afterwards to talk about percutaneous patching and surgery. So when you have a CSF venous fistula, and this is sometimes made for patients and even referring physicians, it's like, you have a CSF venous fistula, diagnosis is made, localization is there, and then you shove everything of your information you have in a black box, and suddenly this comes out. And it's always a question, yeah, why should we do embolization surgery or patching? And that's a good question a lot of patients ask myself. Why should I do this and why shouldn't I do the other stuff? And I think there are some reasons why we consider our advising patients what would be a good idea. And I think one point is, depends on what you have on your hand, right? Do you have like a spinal cord surgeon that is capable of treating a CSF venous fistula or a dural tear? Do you have a neurointerventionist that knows how to treat this? And another factor is what is coming out of an interdisciplinary board, for example. It's not my opinion that I say we need to do embolization. We discuss any case or every case with all the colleagues, and then mostly we give one advice to the patient what we consider would be the best option for you. Another thing that's really important is patient preference. So a lot of patients come in the hospital and see you, and then they have a clear preference on what they prefer and whatnot. But everything we talk about and every therapy we offer the patient should be focused around the available data we have, right? And this is just, at the moment, we have the available data for these three kinds of treatments, and I think we should consider informing the patient around what we know, right? And I will not cover the other one, I will just cover my part. Now, straight to the question, why should we embolize? And like I said, it's my opinion a little bit, and excuse me for that. I think it's a very, very fast and quick procedure. And this is just one case we had in October, from the groin puncture to the femoral vein until we just injected the embolic agent and finished the intervention. It was roughly a little bit more than 20 minutes. We can do this in contrast sedation, so there's no need for general anesthesia. But a lot of patients prefer general anesthesia. That's why we discussed it with the patient itself, but you can do it in contrast sedation. Another thing is we do quite regularly, it's an outpatient treatment. It's just purely transvenous. After the treatment, most of the patient have some sore area where you inject your embolic agent, but mostly that's it. And then we send them home in the evening. So this is a really, really big advantage of this procedure. And that's why I think that's a good reason to embolize. Another thing is it's safe and efficient. So we have some literature, especially from the colleagues from Mayo, that it's improves imaging findings. So when you have like positive findings from brain MRI afterwards, the signs mostly normalize and the brain, the headache improves as well. So we have some data about that. The complication rate is quite low. We see quite regularly patients having like back pain, a local back pain, and something that's like some kind of radiculopathy, but mostly dissolve after 4 weeks. And then rebar hypertension is nothing exclusively for transvenous embolization. I think we see it in any treatment we do. And then the onyx emboli in the lung is, it's not clinically relevant. It doesn't look as nice when you do like CT from the thorax, but this is something we see and would consider complication, but mostly without any risk. There's new data available for more patients, but the results are practically the same. Next reason. Why to embolize? Because when you have a patient with multiple fistula, it's just easy. It just adds to 10, 15 minutes of intervention time and just take another route to another level and then do embolization as well. But sure, you have to know where the fistula is. You just cannot just say, okay, we will prevent recurrence and just do like 5, 6, 7 injections just to prevent recurrence. That doesn't make any sense. But when you know that there are more fistulas, you just can treat them in the same session easily. And when there's an eloquent nerve root, mostly it's not a problem treating them as well transvenously, then you just do the same technique. And it's an eloquent nerve root, but you don't really care about that. Another thing, and this is a little bit counterintuitive as a reason maybe for performing transvenous embolization, because this is a patient where we did transvenous embolization, and we found that there's a recurrence at the same level. Patient had recurrence and symptoms. We saw, okay, there's another fistula. And there's a nice paper from Dr. Schieving that proved that when you perform transvenous embolization and you have a recurrence, you still can perform surgery. So I could argue, okay, then we should always start with transvenous embolization because we still can perform surgery. This likes a little bit provocative, but that could be one argument of why we should perform transvenous embolization first. So, other way around, why we should maybe not perform embolization, and like I said, it's my opinion. So, when you have a recurrent fistula at the same level we treated already, like the case we had before, sometimes it gets a little bit annoying because it's a patient, we did myelography, clear fistula, we went in for transvenous embolization, but we had a hard time getting our embolic agent in the posterior part of the neuroforamen to really occlude all fistula-bearing veins. And we just injected a lot of embolic agent, went into the epidural plex to the contralateral side, and then we said we stop and see if it works. The patient came back with a recurrent fistula. You see it in myography. There is still a vein that's opacifying with contrast agent, and it's exactly where we thought. It's in the posterior part of the neuroframe, so we could really not penetrate it. We went in again, said, okay, well, now we go trend through the epidural plex and try again to embolize it. It still didn't work. We still saw a fistula afterwards. And this is something where we consider maybe in a recurrent fistula, same level, we should go straight for surgery. Another thing is no proven data, but this is something I sometimes see is when you have an extensive cyst, it's sometimes hard getting the embolic agent really to the epidural part of the venous plexus. And because it's just really big and you see already like remodeling of the bone, so maybe this is not a good case for transvenous embolization. This is what I say, other centers would say differently, but that could be one reason. Last couple of slides. So some say, okay, when you inject like onyx like crazy, we will never have a chance afterwards to find a fistula anymore because we have a ton of artifacts. But the good thing is there are new agents arriving where we know we can use different stuff of materials. It's not allowed at the moment, but it will become available next year in Switzerland as well. This is Optura stuff. And the good thing about this, we know it from neurovascular interventions, just a dense part of the embolic agent just to solve. And it will give free vision again afterwards to the area where they're embolized. This would be perfect for transvenous embolization of CSF-venous fistulas as well. So last point is when you have problems with access, maybe you should consider changing your approach or changing to surgery as well. So when you have like thrombosis of the femoral veins or variants, maybe you could consider going for surgery or finding a different way to your fistula itself. Another pretty obvious part is, so when all that I told you about what is necessary to perform transvenous embolization, when everything to those is like you have to answer with no, maybe that's not a good idea of performing transvenous embolization. So take home points. I haven't talked about it, but diagnostic workup is really essential, right? You just go in when you really, really know where it is. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense. There are tons of techniques and routes to go to the femoral veins. You just have to pick one you're familiar with and the techniques and materials you have in your department itself. It's really helpful when you have the alternatives of surgery and transpercutaneous alternatives in your hospital, because then you just are flexible in choosing what's best for your patient, and you need an experienced interventionist. Otherwise, you have a very, very low cure rate and your technique is being discredited. That's a problem itself. If it fails and the patient has still symptoms, don't stop. Look again, do another myelogram, and maybe try to do another therapy again or send to surgery. And keep recurrence in mind, CSF in fistula. And now final slides. I thanks to all my colleagues and especially from Bern and Freiburg, like Jürgen and Thomas, and all the friends I've met throughout the year working in this field. Thanks for the journey. It's a pleasure still. And if anybody has a question, just send me an email or text. Thank you.